everybody, and welcome to episode 15 of the Quill Pens, Quips, Knitting, and More podcast. I am Betsy, also known as Quill Pen on Instagram and Ravelry. There's also the Quill Pens, Quips podcast Instagram and the Quill Pens, Quips, Knitting, and More group on Ravelry that you can join and participate in. And my blog is www.quillpensquips.com, and that's where you can find the show notes for this episode and all previous episodes. And that gets the business stuff out of the way, so welcome back to any returning viewers. Thanks for coming back. And welcome to any new viewers. Thanks for checking me out. I hope you enjoy the episode. Basketball season is over. Yay! We made it. This is our first week, full week of no basketball. And ironically enough, my husband won't be home right after work tonight. But for some reason, the fact that it's not because of basketball makes it okay, makes it better. For some reason in my mind. So we made it through that. So we are turning a corner. Now it'll all be downhill until spring break and then summer. It'll be right around the corner. So things have been going good, settling in with a new baby, being a mom of three boys. I feel like I'm managing. I'm still surviving maybe instead of thriving, but we're all surviving, which is good. Everybody's still alive. So it's been pretty good. And I think that's all the relatively new news. So I think we're ready to get started. So, grab your beverage and, grab your knitting and let's get started. Okay. First up is what's off my needles, and that's nothing. I have not finished anything in the last 2 weeks. That's kind of sad. But it's because everything is still a work in progress, which means I have a lot of things on my needles, which is unusual. And it makes me crazy, which we're going to talk about. It's pretty much the same as the last episode. I'm working on my friend's blanket, which is hard. It's hard to get into something when it's not your project. That's not something that you came in at the beginning of. It's kind of hard to get in and get the flow going. So I'm still working on that. But I've got my snow melt mystery knit along. This is being housed in my Providence Handmade. Here's the tag. Providence Handmade project bag. I love this one. It's a nice drawstring, and it's a nice size, nice medium size, because it was outgrowing the Mrs. Brown's bag that I had it in. Okay, so this is the Snowmelt Mystery Knit Along by Helen Stewart of the Curious Handmade podcast. So spoiler, it's a mystery knit along. If you're doing this mystery knit along and you have not completed clue 3 and you don't want to know what clue 3 looks like finished, avert your eyes for a while because I finished clue 3. So, these are on my Hiya Sharps. Let me see what size I'm doing them on. I'm doing this on a 5, a US 5. That probably means she called for a 6. My little tulip end just went flying. But anyways, so it's hard to show. Goodness, it's huge. So here, basically where we added the blue and the black, my blue and black stripe is clue 3. So it's all, starts there, comes all the way down. I really am enjoying it. I'm not loving the consistent 2-row stripes. It feels a little zebra-esque to me, I don't know. And it's just kind of like two rows. But we're only in clue 3 of 5. So I'm still hoping that there might be some really pretty, you know, bigger sections like there was at the beginning and in here in the middle to finish off. And I think that might help balance out the stripes. So my colors are the Brew City yarn champagne fingering in the wine in a sippy cup. And this one is the Neighborhood Fiber Company. Let me see which, I have it written down for this reason. Neighborhood Fiber Company Studio Sock in the Old Town East is my blue color B. And then this is the Meadowcroft Dye Works in the Rock Shelter Sock in the Fire Pit colorway, which is my color 3. Which I also found it humorous that she outlines colors in her chart, and it's the same colors as mine. So it's kind of like a purpley pink, and then a teal blue, and then a black. And I just thought that was funny because it's matching. So it's helping me mentally to have the matching colors when I look at the pattern. Okay, so that is the snowmelt. And so that's a mystery knit along. A clue comes out once a week, every Thursday. And I normally have the clue finished by Sunday, the latest usually. This week, for example, I had it finished on Saturday. And that gives me a lot of days until Thursday comes around again and a new clue. And so I thought, hey, I'll start a sweater. And I'll work on the sweater for those few days in between. And that'll be fine. My monogamous nature will totally be able to handle having one major project on the needles on a break and starting another major project. So I did. I started it. It is being housed in my sweater bag. And this is from Jan B. Smiley. She's Jan B. Smiley on Etsy and Instagram. She has great project bags and great poke me knots and stuff. In fact, I have her poke me knot for this project too. Okay, so this is, I am doing the Rhapsody in Cables by Hoagy Locatelli. I love this sweater. I am doing it in Quince & Company Lark in the Wren color, in the, hold on. I'm a little discombobulated this morning. Quince & Company Lark in the Crocus colorway, which is this really pretty purple. And I started it. And it is beautiful. It is a really new to me construction, a very unique construction. So this is the neckline going towards the back. So I guess I should be holding it this way. This is how it would go down from the neckline down to the bottom hem. And I love it, and it's going really well. I'm enjoying it, but I can't handle having it. I'd really rather not knit than pick this up right now in the middle, because my mind is focused on the mystery knit along, and I'm not handling attempting to do this in those 4 days in the middle. So I've decided that I'm just gonna take a break from it. I'm gonna hold it off as if I hadn't started it yet. I'm just not able to get into it until this mystery knit along is finished. And I'm realizing that maybe mystery knit alongs don't have a place for me until the mystery's been revealed and I can do it in my own time. All the clues have been released and I can then do it, which sort of defeats the purpose of the mystery knit along. But that might be the way I have to go, or not have the project that I do in the middle few days be another long-term project. It might be a short-term project. So what I'm testing this theory right now by, so this is going, taking a break because it's just not happening. My friends were joking with me after the last podcast. We were out knitting and they had watched it and they said, that's not being monogamous. That's not monogamous knitting. And I was like, sure it is. It's totally fine. And they said, you might not be polygamous yet, but you definitely have a boyfriend. Is how they phrased it. So I'm kicking the boyfriend to the curb for a while. I might bring him back later, but he's not my main, it's not my main squeeze right now. So I'm doing something small this week. That's what I did. I did that part of the sweater last week between after clue 2 finished, before clue 3 is when I got that done. So I didn't even pick it up at all this week. So instead, I got, this is my Brew City Yarns in their, I have it written down, in their premium draft sock. So this is just superwash merino and nylon in the King Creole colorway, because we are getting ready for Mardi Gras. Technically Mardi Gras is going on, but you know, Fat Tuesday is the big day. So we're coming up close on it. So I am making the Sometimes Hat by Vera Sanon, something. This is a free pattern on Ravelry because she says sometimes we just need a fun knit. And this slouchy hat is not only fun to knit, but also fun to wear. And it is fun. So I started this yesterday. This is also on my Hiya Sharps. She calls for a 3 and a 4. I'm doing a 2 and a 3. And so it has kind of a triangular design that, right there you can kind of see. So it has kind of a triangular design that comes around, all the way around. And then there's also this ribbed brim with a pearl reverse garter, I guess, roll at the very brim. Then a rib, and then this part that creates the slouchy, the fun triangles. So I'm loving this colorway. I am a true Southern girl. I grew up in the deep South, on the Gulf Coast of Mississippi, and Mardi Gras is a big deal. Big deal down there. You know, you get off school and you eat a lot of king cake and find little babies in the king cake. And so Mardi Gras is the celebration after Epiphany, the 12th day of Christmas, celebrating until Lent starts, the beginning of Lent on Ash Wednesday, which this carnival, it's the time period of carnival, and then it's a big culmination on Fat Tuesday of all the partying as hard as you can before whatever you're giving up for Lent, which is in most, for most people, would be something like alcohol. So this is my contribution to Mardi Gras this year, my Mardi Gras celebration up here in Virginia where nobody really knows anything about it. So if you see me on Fat Tuesday, I will probably be wearing this, and I'm kind of hoping that I will have enough left over to make some shorty socks, because I'm really loving this yarn, much more, the texture of it, the knitting of it, the feel of it, much more than I thought I might. And so I'm kind of hoping I have enough for shorty socks. So I'm paying attention to my weight as I continue with the hat. I might stop the hat earlier than the pattern calls for if I feel like it's fitting well enough, and make some shorty socks too. Because I still have some time before Fat Tuesday. If I finish this hat, for example, my goal is to finish this hat obviously before Thursday, before the next clue comes out. Then the clue would come out, I'd finish that by Saturday or so, and then whip out a pair of shorty socks before Tuesday. I don't know. So, and this is housed in my, That Clever Clementine? Yes, That Clever Clementine. Super small project bag, very cute. So I'm testing this. If in between Mystery Knit Along clues, can I do short, quick projects and still enjoy them and still want to pick them up and see if it works for me. So those are also on my needles. See, my friends are gonna be like, that's it, you've come over to the dark side, you are officially a polygamous knitter. I don't think I'm quite there yet, but we will see. So then what will be on my needles is the next clue four, which will come out on Thursday. Then my next thing for the Crafty Albatross, and then shorty socks if that works out. My next thing, we draw on the 25th of February, but we have 2 months to complete it, so I don't always start it right away, depending on where I am in other projects. And then clues 4 and 5 of the Mystery Knit Along will be out before my next podcast episode. So that's what's coming up. So then, in terms of acquisitions, I had mentioned last week that not all of my Brew City Hamilton order had arrived. I had shown you the You'll Be Back that I received last time, and then the rest of it came. This is the Wait For It, which is their sparkle base. So this is the Doppelbock Sparkle DK, which is 75% superwash merino, 20% nylon, and 5% stellina. And it's this blue and gold. And Wait For It right now is really probably my favorite song on the album currently. It's just speaking to me a lot right now. So DK Wait, Wait For It. So that's from Brew City. Then I got this wrist ruler from I Love Handles. I'm wearing it right now, actually. It's this one. It is a bracelet that just has a very simple, bobble and hook closure you just put through. And it is a fully functional ruler. In my case, it's a 15 inch. I do believe they have multiple sizes. This one's marked as a size 15. So it goes to 15 inches. I'm guessing that means that there's other options, smaller and or larger. I have not gone to the website. The website is www.ilovehandles.com. And this one is the medium. There's also a dark and apparently a black. But I got the medium. And I love it. I got it just because it's super unique and yet functional, and I really like those kinds of jewelry pieces. As you can tell from my abacus bracelet that I also have on, that I'm using with my hat right now. I was also using this one with my hat earlier because I was measuring how far I had gotten, and it was handy right there. I didn't have to pull out my measuring tape. So I love it. It's a fun little statement piece, if you will, for a crafter, and I think it's been really fun. And then I got a new book that I'm very excited about. I got Clara Park's The Knitter's Book of Yarn. This book is like a textbook, y'all. Do you guys have this? Have you heard of this? Oh my goodness, there is so much information in here, and it's just like the content, like a textbook, but it reads very easily. It's easy to get into. I can't think of the phrase that I'm trying to think of, but it's very easy to read, but you're getting a ton of information. It doesn't sound academic. It doesn't feel academic, but you're learning a lot. And then there's also a ton of projects and patterns in here. About different plies and different weights and helping you learn why it works for certain things and why it doesn't for others. Talks about the different animal fibers, the different man-made fibers, what they do, what project you would want them for, how they react to the elements, how they react to washing, when you want it to felt or when you don't want it to felt, all those kinds of things. When you want structure, when you want drape, or whether you want to highlight a cable or highlight a lace pattern, what you want to use. So The Knitter's Book of Yarn, I have not gotten very far. I'm still, reading about the protein fibers, the very first section. I'm slowly working my way through, and I'm already, I feel like I need to take notes because I'm learning so much. So I highly recommend, if you can find it from your library. I got this off of Amazon. Knitter's Book of Yarn by Clara Parks. It's exactly, if you've heard good things about it, everyone that told you good things was exactly right. I find it an investment well worth spending the time with just to really get to know fiber and yarn. And it says the ultimate guide to choosing, using, and enjoying yarn. And it really is. I think this is going to be, a game changer in helping me choose yarns and why you want certain yarns for certain things. So I'm very excited about that new purchase. So now we're going to talk about some designing conundrum that I have. So I recently fell in love with some yarn. And sitting there calling my name. It's this. It's kind of a maroon and brown and pink and cream. This is Madeline Tosh. This one is vintage in the Marfa, M-A-R-F-A, Marfa colorway. And it just kept speaking to me in the shop. And I would walk by it and I'd think, wow, that's really gorgeous. And then I'd walk in another room and it'd be on a different base and I'd be like, wow, that's really, and then I'd be like, oh, it's the same thing. It's just a different base. So finally I said, you know what? I can't stop thinking about it. It's meant to be something in my life. I'm going to get it. But they didn't have enough in any one base. I feel like it needs to be a wearable garment for me. It's calling to me to be worn as more than an accessory, more than a cowl, more than a hat. It wants to be an actual, you know, something to wear, a garment. But they didn't have enough in any one base to make anything that would fit me. And it's be for me. I'm not making it for my kid. Not making a child size anything. So I left it there. And I went home and I thought about it. And I just couldn't get this yarn off my mind. Please tell me I'm not the only one who like dreams about yarn. And so I said, well, I'm gonna sleep on it. I'll think about it. And I kept thinking about it. Couldn't let go of it. And so I scoured Ravelry for anything that has multiple weights in the one project. Because they had a decent amount of vintage, which is worsted. They had one skein of sport. And then they had one skein of the ASAP, which is super bulky. So I have a few skeins of worsted, one skein of sport, and one skein of bulky. And there is absolutely nothing on Ravelry that includes all of these bases. So I said, I'm crazy. I can't do it. It can't be done. And then I woke up the next morning and I said, you know what? I'm a designer. I design things. I can make something up. And in my head, it totally works, right? I'm thinking like a vest, because I don't have a ton of yardage. Thinking a vest, I'm thinking, you know, the button band could be in one weight, like the bulky weight maybe. Then like maybe do a stripe-esque thing around the waistline, especially if it was a high waistline, in the sport, which would almost create shaping without really creating shaping. And that works in my head, right? I'm not crazy, am I? My husband said that basically what this means is that people from now on are gonna either like click unfollow right now and be like, that girl is crazy. Don't follow her. Or everyone's gonna follow me like, this girl's awesome. She's designing things that no one's ever, you know, why didn't I think of that? So I am now studying the construction of vests. I've never even knit a vest, let alone designed one. So I'm pulling from different vest construction websites and, you know, like sewing type vest constructions to figure out how to design a vest. And other knitting patterns to see how they do it, when they do it top down or I'm thinking a cardigan, maybe? I don't know. So I'm thinking I'm going to design something across a bunch of weights. And we're gonna see what happens because I love this yarn and it's speaking to me. So I'm in the research phase of the design project, I guess. I'm still kind of doing thought process, mood board type thing. So stay tuned. There might be something fun coming up in the design side of things. So now let's move to the next section. So I'm making this its own section because I'm hoping that in the future, this will be a decent chunk of our knitting community and one of the things we do together. And so right now I have the Just Do It Cal going on. I just opened the threads this morning. Sorry that took me so long. So there's a chatter thread and then a finished object thread. So this is a Just Do It Cal. Is there something laying around or that's been in your mind and you haven't done it yet? Just do it. This is for something that's new, something that you've been hesitant to do or haven't wanted to do. You know, if you always thought, oh, knitted socks are great, but I've never wanted to knit a pair of socks. Just do it. Knit a pair of socks. Or why would anybody work with lace weight yarn? Just do it. Work with lace weight yarn. Do some cables. Read a chart. Try crochet. Try spinning. If you know, you purchased this great yarn at a fiber festival that has yak in it, and now you don't know what to do with it, just do it. Just knit with it. Do something. So this is the cow to just expand your horizons and get stuff done. You know, if it's like, I've never done this project before, so I'm going to do this project, that doesn't quite count, right? It needs to have a reason behind it to be eligible for prizes. I don't know how strict I'm going to be. Try me. Make it up. Find a reason that it works and qualifies, and we will see. I'm pretty sure that I'm going to be lenient and anything will go. But, you know, to sort of say, oh, I've knit 16 sweaters, but I've never knit this sweater. Let's branch out a little bit more than that. So the chatter thread is where you can talk about ideas or show progress or get feedback or help, suggestions, anything like that. Then the finished object thread will be for the finished objects. Post a picture, post why it counts, and then prize winners will be drawn from the finished object thread. This cal runs from now. Whips are allowed. Poly dipping is allowed. So it runs from now until the end of the year. It's going to be a whole year thing. So I'm really trying to generate interest. Tell your friends. Have them join the group. You must be a member of the Quill Pens Quips Knitting and More Ravelry group to be eligible to win a prize. So tell your friends, join the group. And let me think what else. It's anything you knit, crochet, weave, spin, dye, anything fibery that would go on Ravelry counts. And if you have any questions, post them in the chatter thread, let me know. And let's just have fun with it. Let's just do it. So that is the cal. There might be another cal that I will be adding to this section in the future. I'm still waiting to hear. It would be starting probably April, I think, and run through the rest of the year. So that's it for cals. Let's move on. Okay, this is my new, brand new, love it or leave it section. This is where I'm going to do some reviews, product reviews, probably. And this was a suggestion by my friend Kristen, T-Rex Knitter, and I really liked it. I thought it was a great idea. So today, I really want to review, and I should have, I don't have a project able to show it to you on, so I apologize for that. But these cable needles. This one is from Knitter's Pride. And I originally thought that maybe that was it. I'd never seen these before. I was having a lot of trouble with cable needles that either have the, you know, the like dip in them or the ones that are the U shape. I was having some trouble with them. And I didn't really like cabling because of that. And so these were suggested to me and given to me. I love them. So it has little notches. I don't know how well you can see that, but they have little notches in them. And they, so far I've seen them, they come in a set of three. A thin, this one is equivalent to a US 6. So there's like three different sizes to match your knitting. And I keep thinking it's not gonna work well, that the yarn's gonna get stuck in these notches, but it doesn't. It gets stuck enough to be held and secure, but then sort of just like a slight twist, gets it right back to the end and makes it easy to knit from. Now that I'm talking about this on here, I will attempt to film a demonstration of using this in cable and post it on the blog and on the YouTube channel of using it. And like I said, I originally thought I could only find these with Knitter's Pride, and I was having some trouble finding some new ones because I lost one. But I actually just found that they're on KnitPicks, knitpicks.com. So, and you can get, you know, your favorite color choice. So this came in a set of three. And this one doesn't, it did have a size, but it's rubbed off, I think. Oh, maybe not. There's no sizes. So there's like a thin one, and then a little bit thicker, and then thickest. So, I don't know what's the best place to show you the little notches. I love these. If you're cabling anything, whether you're a new cabler or a veteran cabler, try these. Let me know what you think. Do you use these already? Have you used these? Now, another cable needle that I was recently introduced to is this same type, and then it just kind of gets real thin in the middle and then gets thick again at the edge. And I'm told that that works really nicely too. So I would think that between all the cable needles in the world that you can use, this type and that type would be my top recommendation. But try these. You know what? You could do a cable project. Try these new cable needles if they're new to you, and that could count for the cow, and you would be eligible for a prize. So, these, I don't even know if they have a name, but notched, I'm calling them my notched cable needles. Highly recommend. Love them. Not going to leave them. Definitely love them. Highly recommend them. So, if you have any suggestions for products you would like me to review and decide whether I would love it or leave it, let me know, and we'll add them to a future episode. Next is reading and watching. So I finished two of the Agatha Christie's, the three. One, we were reading Murder on the Orient Express as the main one. And then if you wanted to continue more, if you had time, the other two options we threw out there was the ABC Murders and Then There Were None. So I finished the Murder on the Orient Express and Then There Were None. And I have read both of these before, so it was kind of nice to read. This is the first time I've read them where I really knew what happened, who did it, the end. I was reading it much more like a Columbo. The classic storyline of a Columbo is that you see the murder happen, you know who did it, you know why they did it, basically, and then Columbo comes in and starts asking questions, and you watch him figure it out. You get to watch the guy, you know, not guy or girl, who did it, get questioned, and how they cover their tracks and all that, which isn't for everybody. Some people hate that when they see who did it right off the bat, but I kind of enjoy that. I feel like it has its place. And so this time these Agatha Christie's read like a Columbo to me, where I already knew from the very beginning who did it, and I got to watch Hercule Poirot ask questions. I got to see how the perpetrator acted around the other people, how they covered their tracks, how they hid themselves. And so I really enjoyed that. So next is the ABC Murders, which I also remember the ending. So if I don't get to it, my mother currently has the copy of it, but she says she's going to be done very, very soon, and then I can read it. I also remember the ending to that one, so it'll be fun to reread that one in the same way. I also finished The Prince Warriors by Priscilla Shire. I don't know their name. Shire. I don't know. And I really liked it. I finished number one. I have not started number two yet. I do own number two. I think there's three total. I really enjoyed it. It's definitely youth. It is definitely religious fiction, which for me is okay, good. And I'm really excited about having it in our household for a household of boys. I feel like it I really liked how it taught character, not just for boys, but for girls too, but just character and knowing how to fight battles well and knowing which battles to fight in the world. Talking about bullying or just choosing the right path versus the wrong path when you're faced with a decision and one looks easy and one looks hard, and making good choices and being a person of character in all of your interactions with people. And so I really like the message that it's sending. It is a youth read. It's easier language to follow. It's an exciting storyline, but it's short. And so I'm really excited to have it. And I'm enjoying the read for myself, and I'm excited to have it in our personal family library. So I do recommend that, The Prince Warriors by Priscilla Shire. Currently, I just finished On My Nook, which had been in my library, and I don't remember it, so I don't think I had read it before, is a murder mystery written by the author of Winnie the Pooh. A.A. Milne, who wrote Winnie the Pooh, wrote a murder mystery called The Red House Mystery. It was really good. I really enjoyed it. I was so surprised to see an adult murder mystery written by the guy who wrote Winnie the Pooh. You know, it just kind of throws you for like, was this going to be good? And it really was. It was very well done. Totally different genre, and he nailed it. So very good. I would definitely recommend The Red House Mystery by A.A. Milne. That's basically what I'm reading. This Is Us, the anxiety episode with Randall. It was beautiful. I feel like they tackled a hard topic and they handled it well. I feel like they handled it pretty accurately as someone who has experienced panic attacks. And it was beautiful. The only thing, totally off topic of that, still in This Is Us. So Kevin being super nervous about the play, I get that as an actress, I get the whole being nervous before a play thing, but they're really playing it up. The fact that he like came from the TV show, like he came from a TV show actor to stage, and how different that is. But he did a studio audience TV show. So every time he acted in the Manny, there was a live audience right there. Granted, you know, you can probably stop and start. I'm not quite sure how all that goes. But you're still dealing with people sitting there watching you. And it seemed like that's what he was so nervous about the play. And that seemed like a discrepancy to me. Does anybody agree with that? It seemed weird that he's so nervous about the play because there's people there. And, you know, the New York Times is there and the critics are there and how the critics are going to crucify him. But it just doesn't seem too different than the filming of the Manny. He's not coming from movie filming where there's no audience watching and you can stop and start a million times and probably do. He's filming from a live studio audience to performing in front of a live audience. So I don't know. I was kind of like, why are you so nervous? I don't get that. But it's still very good. I'm dreading how and when the father dies. I keep back like, do you think this is when he dies? And my husband's like, I don't know, but they're doing a good job stringing you along a little bit and keeping you on your toes. So I love it. If you haven't gotten into it again, please give it a try. I think you would like it. It has a little something for everybody. There's something for everybody to enjoy. We realized we had completely lost track of Lucifer, so we started watching some Lucifer, came back to Lucifer, and it continues to crack me up. I forget how much I enjoy the humor in those scripts about Lucifer and being the devil and just the jokes that get thrown in because of that. We're still watching Blacklist. Still very good. I'm interested to see the spinoff. The Blacklist that it doesn't, from the previews, it appears not to have Lizzie in it, which is the drawback to the regular Blacklist. And it does have Tom, which is, you know, the draw of the regular Blacklist. So I'm interested in that. We haven't watched it yet. I don't even know if it's out yet, but I'm intrigued by that. I would like to probably watch that. And then recently, not that this is a new movie, it's not by any stretch of the imagination, but around Valentine's Day, I don't think it was Valentine's Day, but we watched Return to Me, which is probably my favorite romantic comedy of all times. It's really funny and cute and sweet and sad and heartwarming all at the same time. I think my husband even likes it. I think this is the second time he's watched it with me, second or third. I love it. Go watch it. If you haven't, even if you have, rewatch it. It's worth rewatching. It's just so sweet. I don't want to give anything away. Although I probably could, because I probably was on the back of the movie. But it's funny, it's cute. I really enjoyed it. I enjoy it every time I watch it. It never gets old. Return to Me. Check it out. So that's all that I've been watching. Okay. So, moving on. Okay. For today's signing section, I'm going to do something a little bit different. Right now, on the internet, in the deaf community, on Facebook, various places on the internet, is a new challenge called the No Facial Expression Challenge. The goal is to sign something for 30 seconds with no facial expression. No eyebrows, no smiles, nothing. In sign languages, facial expression is the equivalent to vocal intonation. So it's very important. It can totally change the meaning of what you're signing just by facial expression. It would be like trying to do a challenge of talking and only speaking in monotone. It would be hard. So it's this new challenge that's going out, hashtag no facial expression. So I am gonna do, I've seen different things. I've seen just a story being signed with no facial expression. I've seen poems done with no facial expression. So I am gonna do the song, You'll Be Back, You'll Be Back, from Hamilton. And it's one of my favorite songs. It's the king from England singing about America leaving and how you'll be back. But I think it's even more funny without the facial expression. So I'm gonna try. The goal is for 30 seconds. The song is like 3 minutes. So I tend to do the eyebrow during the song when I've been practicing. So we're gonna try for 30 seconds and see how it goes. So enjoy. This is my contribution for hashtag no facial expression.
Not a price that you're willing to pay. You cry your tea, which you earn in the sea, when you see me go by. Why so sad? Remember we made an arrangement when you went away. Now you're making me mad. Remember, despite our estrangement, I'm your man. Soon you'll see, you'll remember you belong to me. You'll be back, time will tell. You'll remember that I served you well. Oceans rise, empires fall. We have seen each other through it all. And when push comes to shove,
So that is it for this episode. Thank you for watching, and I got through it all, I think. I had my notes with me, and I didn't have to stop too many times to take care of children who don't think the nap time is what they should be doing right now. So I hope you enjoy your Monday, enjoy your week. It's true. It might not be Monday when you're watching this. It might not even be Monday when I get this posted, but it's Monday right now. So I hope you enjoy your week, and happy knitting, and I'll see you next time. Bye.